Hello, this is Mr. Collier, and today we're doing the normal distribution and calculating some probabilities using the calculator with the normal distribution. Okay, so it's very useful. It's got this shape. Perhaps you've seen it before or heard of the bell curve. And it comes up a lot in real life. It comes up in heights of people. So if the average height of a country, the average height of males is 1.7 meters or something. You'll have a lot of people at like 1.75 or 1.65. But as you get taller, like 2 meters, there's less and less people. 2.1 meters, less and less people. So it kind of gets lower and lower and lower like this here. Okay, and conversely, people shorter than 1.7 meters, there's a lot of them. But as you go shorter and shorter, there's less of those people. Okay, so this happens a lot in nature. People have noticed this for the last 250 years or so. When they collect data on things, it usually follows this distribution, or often follows this distribution. Okay, IQs follow this distribution, with an average of 100 right in the middle, and then like 115 is one standard deviation above, and 85 is one standard deviation below. It's very symmetric like this. Okay, other things are like measurements. If you measure something with a ruler like a million times, on average you'll get this. And it'll follow this curve right here. So a little bit more than average and less than average will be pretty high. Then the extreme values are lower. Things like certain athletes' race times will have a certain average. And sometimes they do really well and sometimes they don't do so well. But it follows this general distribution. So it occurs a lot. It's very important. The mean is in the middle. We'll call that mu. And the mean, median, mode are the same because the highest probability is right in the middle, and this splits it into 50% and 50%, so it's also the median, so they're all the same. Okay, this is mu plus one standard deviation, and then plus two standard deviations, and plus three standard deviations, and then minus one standard deviation, and two standard deviations, and then minus three standard deviations. And all these curves, you get the same statistics. You get like 65%, 68% occurs within one standard deviation. Okay, so in the case of IQ scores with a mean of 100 and standard deviation of 15, 68% of all IQ scores are supposed to be between 85 and 115. Okay, and then within two standard deviations, it's always going to be about 95%. So 95% of like IQs will be between 70 and 130. And then plus or minus three standard deviations, 99.7%, I believe, is between that. You can get the exact values on your calculator, which I'll show you in a bit. So most of the time we're going to be using our calculators for these questions. You don't really need to know these values per se, but they're useful to know to get an idea to check the reasonableness of your answers. But you do need to know about the symmetry of the graph and things like that for some questions. Okay, and if you want to know the probability of somebody being between, like, for example, 100 and 115 IQ, then basically you can get the area under the curve. Basically. Okay, the normal distribution is a continuous probability distribution, continuous, which means the probability of any one particular thing is practically zero. So we're going to be looking at CDFs rather than PDFs. We're going to be looking at probabilities like x is greater than 115, for instance, rather than the probability x equals 93, which is what you kind of want. You want ranges for this kind of thing anyway. Okay, this is the notation. So we say x has a normal distribution of mu and sigma squared, which is the variance, right? Even though we're always talking about sigma, the standard deviation, and we're always typing into the calculator standard deviation, the written notation is like this for some reason. Okay? So let's take a look at, oh, there's the formula. This formula, if you graph it, will generate a bell curve. Okay, but you need some calculus skills to be able to derive it. So here's what the actual formula looks like, but you don't need to know that for now. Let's look at some probabilities. This is a normal this is a normal distribution of 12 and 9. That means the mean is 12. Remember, the standard deviation is going to be 3. Okay, the square root of that number. So this is the distribution. So it's going to look like this. I'll just draw this sketch. The middle value is going to be 12. And then you've got three up and three down. In between here, you got 68% of the, there's a 68% chance of x being between 9 and 15, basically, and so forth. This is asking for the probability between 10 and 13. So 10 is about there, and 13 is about there. So it looks like a fairly big probability, maybe a little bit less than 50%. Okay, now this is the same as, now the probability of exactly 10 is effectively 0, but this is the same as probability 10 less than or equal to x, less than or equal to 13. We can use less than or equal to interchangeably. Okay, it doesn't matter because it's a continuous probability distribution function. It's the same thing because the probability of exactly 13 or exactly 10 is effectively 0. Anyway, I'll show you how to do that on the HB prime calculator. Just let me make this a bit smaller, and let me open that up again. So, and smaller. Okay, so you go to the toolbox here and go to probability. We never use normal PDF, we always use CDF, the cumulative distribution function. So normal CDF, and we need between 10 and 13, but the first two things you type in are the mean and the standard deviation. So let's type in 12, comma 3, comma 10, comma 13. Will give you the probability between 10 and 13. So you get about 37.8% or 0.378, right? Which makes sense given our graph, right? So this probability is, well, oh, actually 9 is right there. So if you remember, I said before that this is, well, this is obviously 50% to the right of the mean, and this region is supposed to be 68% about. So this is 48%, and it should be about 84%, okay, if you have those percentages memorized. But let's check out what the calculator does exactly. So let me copy and paste that. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. Let's copy and paste that, and 12, 3 stays the same, and you need to type in 9. And then you need a really big number, because this tail goes off forever, actually. So you need to type in infinity, but you can't type infinity on your calculator, so you can do 10 to the power of 99, which is the biggest number in your calculator. You can probably get an accurate answer using a much smaller number, but you might as well stick with 10 to the power of 99 as infinity. That'll give you the probability x is greater than 9 and less than 10 to the power of 99. So that's 84.1%. So that is approximately what we got before. This one's pretty easy. You don't even need your calculator because the mean is 12. So the probability x less than the mean is always 50% because of the symmetry of the normal distribution. Okay, let's move on to another question. Okay, we have x as a normal distribution of 34. So mu equals 34. Standard deviation equals the square root of 4, which is 2. What's the probability x is greater than 35? So let's just simply, now there's two parts to this question. I'm just going to call it A and B. So that, we just type into our calculator. Let me copy and paste. But this has a mean of, let's delete the whole thing. This is 34, comma, oops, yeah, that's right, 2, comma, what do we need now? We need the lower part, 35. And then the upper is infinity. Again, 10 to the power 99. Okay, and we get this number 0.309. Okay, so 34 is in the middle. 35 is just to the right, so it should be less than 50%, or it has to be less than 50%. So this percentage is actually 30, 0.9%, right? So that's that probability. If two values are chosen at random, what's the probability they're both greater than 45? So this is now switched to a binomial distribution, right? Because you're doing it multiple times. You're conducting this experiment, let's say, twice. So let's say y has a binomial distribution. We're doing something twice. We're looking at the probability. Actually, we don't really need to think of it as a binomial distribution either, I guess. We could just simply, because there's just two events, probability they're both greater than 35 is just 0.309 times 0.0309, assuming they're independent events, right? So let me just square the number in our calculator. You could also use the binomial theorem and type it in, but this is a simple version of the binomial theorem, so you can just square our answer. And that's not how I do that. Just copy and paste and square it. So that's 0.0952. Okay, next, let's look at this question. By the way, in IB questions, they'll always tell you if the data is normally distributed. Never assume it is. If they don't say it in the question, then it's not a normal distribution question. So we have a mean of 15, standard deviation of 4. So x has a normal distribution of 15, 4 squared. What's the probability I'm late on Monday? So the probability of being late is more than 20 minutes. Okay, it should be less than 50% because there's 15 and 20 is there. So we're talking about this probability, right? Let's type that into the calculator. Let me copy and paste that. Copy, paste, greater than 20. So we have 15 as the mean. Standard deviation is 4. We want this to be 20, and the maximum is infinity. So we get 0.1056, which is 6, right? But you may want to write down more digits. Because it's a multi-part question, you want more accuracy for your next parts. What's the probability I will be late twice in 1 week? Okay, this is binomial for sure. Let's say y has a binomial distribution. There's 5 days in a week. We're looking for the probability of being late exactly 2 times. And the probability of being late once is 0.106. This number on your calculator, right? So, actually, let me write down the whole thing. 0.1056497, just in case we need it. Okay, this is, let's go to the calculator then and go to toolbox. Binomial density, right? Because it's probability y equals 2, so it's a probability density function. Binomial, let's type in 5. Comma, can I copy and paste? I can just copy and paste this thing, I think. Yeah, there you go. That's the probability of success. And 2 is the probability we're looking for. And we get 0.0798 is the probability, okay? Next, given that I am late, so this is going to be a conditional probability, what's the probability the walk took more than 25 minutes? So the probability x is greater than 25 given x is greater than 20, because that's the probability of late. We can just use the conditional probability formula. What's the probability x is greater than 25 and x is greater than 20 divided by probability x is greater than 20. Now if you think about the numerator, what's the probability of x greater than 25 and greater than 20? That's the same as the probability x greater than 25, right? If it's greater than 25 and it's greater than 20, it's just greater than 25. The denominator is greater than 20. So we already have this probability in part A. So we just need the first one, the numerator. I guess we could set this up as a fraction. Hang on a second. Fraction where our numerator is, let's do this, probability, cumulative, normal. Oh, I could have copied and pasted, I suppose, 15, 4, 25 and then 10 to the power of 99. That's the probability of being between 25 to infinity. This one, can I copy and paste my, this one right here? This one, okay. Okay, there we go. Let's divide that and we get 0.0588. Okay, let's move on to the next part. Standard normal distribution. Okay, so this is the standard normal distribution. It has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So if you look at this graph, what you see is what you get, because this means one standard deviation above the mean is 1, and two standard deviations above the mean is 2, and three standard deviations above the mean is this, right? But you can take any normal distribution curve and change it to this with a couple simple transformations. So let's look at IQs. IQs have a mean of 100, standard deviation of 15. So if you want to transform this into this, you can just, to get it to be centered on 0, you can just subtract 100 from everything. Okay, so you take all the x values, so all the values, and subtract the mean, which is 100. Okay, and you'll get it centered on 0, but then you have 0, 15, 30. If you want it to be this number, you got to divide by 15, right? Okay, so for example, 100 minus 100 is 0. 0 divided by 15 gives you 0. 115 minus 100 is 15. 15 divided by 15 is 1. So it'll take all these numbers on this curve and turn it into this one. Okay, so we call this the standard normal curve because of this, and this is standardizing the normal. And it's also got a name, the Z distribution, for some reason. Okay, so this is in the IB formula booklet. This is the definition of a z-score, as some people call it. So z equals x minus mu over sigma. This value will always give you how many standard deviations above or below the mean a certain probability is. Okay. So, for example, this probability here is within one standard deviation of the mean. We already saw that's going to be about 68%, right? On your calculator, I think you might get 68.4 or something more exact answer. So doing this transformation, it was very important back in the days of no calculator when you're using tables and stuff. That way you can have one table with these values instead of a bunch of different tables. We still have some applications that we can see next time, and we're going to use it here in a second too. State how many standard deviations 22 is above the mean from this distribution. So this is mean is 20. Standard deviation is 5. Remember the square root of 25. So how many standard deviations is 20 above the 22 above the mean? So this is what it looks like. 20 is in the middle. 25 is one standard deviation. 22 is right there. That's 22. Okay, but you can just simply get the z-score to figure out this question. You just do 22 minus 20 divided by the standard deviation. That gives you 2/5 or 0.4. Okay, so it is 0.4 standard deviations above the mean. All right, now let's check out this one. Probability x is greater than 22. Actually, this is the same as probability x is great, not x, sorry. It's the same as the probability of z being greater than 0.4. Okay, so if you look at the normal distribution, the standard normal distribution has 0 and 1 here. Okay, and then you would have a 0.4 right there. It's in exactly the same spot. So it's going to be exactly the same probability over here. So you can do this one or you can do this one here. And, well, I guess back in the past you had to do this one here because it was all in terms of the standard normal distribution. To work that out, let's go check out what it says in our calculator. Let's go to cumulative normal. And I'm going to go to help. Help. Now, these things in square brackets, that means you don't actually need them. OK, Okay, so you can actually if you don't type in the mean and standard deviation, it is the standardized normal distribution with the mean of 0 and the standard deviation of 1. So I don't need to use that. So I can just type in 0.4, comma infinity, which is 10 to the power 99. Oops. And it'll give me this here. So it's assuming the standard normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. So that's going to be 0.345 rounded up to 3 significant figures. Now take a look at this one. This is actually going to be negative 0.4 standard deviations away from the mean. So this is the same as probability z less than negative 0.4. Because of the symmetry of the graph, this probability here is the same as that probability right there. So it's also going to be 0.345 because of the symmetry. This always works. Okay? This will always work that way. Okay, this one here, I guess you could get the z-scores. Yeah, let's do that. You could do it with the actual distribution, but this is 18 was 0.4 away from the mean, 19 is 0.2 away from the mean, so negative 0.2, less than z, less than, and this is 3 away from the mean, so that's 0.06 away from the mean. So we can type in on our calculator, let's do that. Actually, oh yeah, that's right, okay, so we need to type in negative 0.02 and 0.06. Okay, so you get 0.0, what have I done? Sorry, I made a mistake. This is just 0.2 and 0.6. Sorry, I don't know why I put another one there. It's obviously too small, so I knew I made a mistake right away because those numbers were too small. That's what happens when you have good understanding of what the curve looks like. This is the actual probability. So 0.305. Okay, let's take a look at the next question. What's the probability? Now this is the same true for this is true for any distribution. One standard deviation is about 68%. Two standard deviations should be about 95%. But let's get the actual answer on a calculator, see how close that is, actually. So this is between negative 2, probably negative 2 less than z less than 2. Let's see what happens on our calculator. So I'm going to press enter there. And, oh, no, not enter. I want to copy. Okay, so this is going to be negative 2. And it's actually 95.4 to be more accurate. 95.4%. Okay, let's look at this. So this person's got 90, chemistry, they got 72%. In biology, they've got 68%. That doesn't really mean much unless you know the difficulty of the test, right? But fortunately, if you get the z-score, you can see how much above or below the mean they got for each test, so you can actually make a better comparison. So the z-value for chemistry is 72 minus the mean of the class divided by the standard deviation of the class. The z-score for biology is 68 minus the class average divided by the standard deviation. This gives you 1.2, and this gives you 0.875. So you can see, relative to the rest of the class, this student did better in chemistry than in biology.